no matter what you're going through. I know that you can stand, for your life is in His hands.
Just bear in mind, because it's such a significant time, such a significant day. Because so often, we just take the table of the Lord in a ritual. You know, we kind of do this every month, and we think it's just part of the process and part of normality. There's so much significance in the table of the Lord. That the body was broken for each one of you sinners. The blood was shed for you. And we know that there's power in the blood. There's healing, there's deliverance in the blood of Jesus Christ. And even as I shared this word this morning, and it's just so appropriate that what I felt the Lord laid upon my heart, that's tying in with the covenant here. The covenant promises this morning. So just to touch on Hebrews chapter 7 verse 23, it says here, also there were many priests. Also there were many priests. I'm just starting off there. But you see, when you go through Hebrews chapter 6, in fact the latter part of chapter 6, and I'll pick up on that a bit later, and Hebrews chapter 7, it really compares Jesus Christ with the traditional Levitical priesthood. Okay? So as you know, in the Old Testament, there was a sacrificial system. That means they used to sacrifice, administered obviously by the priesthood. Okay? So priests in the ancient Israel were only from the tribe of Levi. So if you are born a boy into that family, which is the tribe of Levi, you are going to be a priest. If you are born in any other tribe, you're not going to be a priest. Only out of the tribe of Levi would you become a priest. Otherwise, you would not enter into that priesthood. So as we know, once a year on the Day of Atonement, the high priest Israel would enter into the Holy of Holies and offer sacrifices on behalf of the people. And one of the purposes of the sacrificial system, and when the high priest went to the Holy of Holies, to continually remind the people of their sins. Not only to remind them of their sins, but to remind them of the consequences of their sins. And in as much as we might say this is an Old Testament, but I wonder sometimes whether we should continue to remind people of the sins without bringing condemnation. More so, I think we should bring in a remembrance and remind people of the consequences of the sin. Not bringing condemnation, because we know who we are in Christ. We know who we are in Christ. But that was the system in the Old Testament. But as you know, and you look through it, everything of the Old Testament points towards the future. Points towards, and even that sacrifice that was made, points only to Jesus. As you and I know, Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice. Amen. And that's why we can come before the communion table. So when you look at Hebrews chapter 7, the author, which we don't know who it is, compares Jesus to a figure in the Old Testament called Melchizedek. He compares the model of the priesthood represented by Jesus and Melchizedek to the Old Testament of the Levitical priesthood. Okay? So I'm just setting some foundation here. And so that's why I want to minister this morning on a priest in the order of Melchizedek. A priest in the order of Melchizedek. So it might sound big, it might sound, but just stay with me. Amen? Just stay with me. So let's just go back to Genesis chapter 14. And we're going to go through and let's pick up some things. Hallelujah. So Genesis chapter 14, picking up from verse 14, it says, as you know, that Abram, as he was known then, was returning from a military victory over some Canaanite kings. But picking up from verse 14, now when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his 318 trained servants. So you can imagine how Abram was wealthy. Because he had 318 of his own servants, of his own men that would go to war. His own army. Okay? He armed his 318 trained servants, which were born in his own house, and went in pursuit as far as Dan. He divided his forces against them by night, and he and his servants attacked them and pursued them as far as Hobah, which is the north of Damascus. So he brought back all the goods, and also brought back his brother Lot and his goods, as well as the women and the people. Amen. And in verse 17, and the king of Sodom went out to meet him in the valley of Shaveh, that is the king's valley, after his return from the defeat of the Chedorlaomer. Sounds Spanish, Italian, Greek, and the kings who were with him. But obviously when Abram was coming back, Sodom went to meet with him first. There were many other kings, but Sodom, the king of Sodom, went to meet with him first. Very interesting. Because as you know, and so often happens, is that when you come out of a place of victory, when God has broken through for you, and you've got your victory, you've got your employment, you've got this new business, you've got this victory, that breakthrough that you're attracting the Lord for, you were in a place of rejoicing. Because you're rejoicing and said, I've defeated the enemy, the enemy has been defeated, I've got what I wanted, God has broke through for me. And you're walking towards and being back to your home. Suddenly, the king of Sodom comes. Why? Because here's the reality. So often, we concern and mourn, how can I put it? Really fasting and prayer and mourn our God when we really went through that valley experience. But what about when we're in the top? When we've got our victory. At the time when we have our victory, we are most vulnerable. We are most vulnerable. Why? Because we're rejoicing in our victory and we let our God down. We let our God down. And what happens is the king of Sodom comes. The king of Sodom is a king of unrighteousness. Because the enemy will come, and some people will come that are used by the enemy to divert you. And not focus on the Lord God Almighty who has delivered you, but divert you into another place. And divert you and say, you know what? Well, let me come and join with you. Be careful who you yoke with. Be careful who you yoke with. And the time that you're up on the mountaintop is when you are most vulnerable. Because then you think you've arrived and says, you know what? Hey, here's the king of Sodom has come. Let me do some business. Let me do something with him. Maybe you think you're getting married, and maybe you think, well, that individual would be the right person, but he is the king of Sodom. The king of unrighteousness. Very interesting. At what a time that he's come, at the time that Abram, the appointed one, hallelujah, the chosen, but God's faithful, amen? God's faithful. And he goes on, then Melchizedek, king of Salem, of Jerusalem, brought out the bread and the wine. He brought out the bread and the wine. He was the priest of the God Most High. Amazing. And I'm going to talk about Melchizedek. That Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out the bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. You see, kings might come to you like the king of Sodom, but who comes in righteousness? Look at this thing. With Melchizedek, and I'll explain about Melchizedek. Melchizedek not only was the king of Salem, and Salem talks about Jerusalem, talks about shalom, shalim, nothing missing, nothing broken, a wholeness. Amen? That's the king he is, Melchizedek. But not only is he a king, he's also a priest of the Most High God. He's also a priest of the Most High God. Amen? And it's significant because I'm going to take you somewhere with that. So Melchizedek was both king of righteousness and priest, exactly like Jesus. Jesus is our king and our priest and our high priest. He is our king and our high priest. And as you know, Melchizedek is a type of Jesus. It's a type of Jesus. And then in Genesis chapter 14, same chapter, verse 19, and he blessed whom Melchizedek blessed him, Abram, and said, blessed be Abram, God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. That's the God we serve. He's a possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hands. Who has delivered. The first thing you need to do when you have your victory, when you have your breakthrough, is you need to bless the Lord. Because he's the one that won the battle for you. Because the battle is not ours, the battle is the Lord's. Amen. He's the one that gives us the victory. And as he says here, he said, blessed be God who has delivered you. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us from them all. But the Lord delivers us from them all. Who has delivered your enemies into your hands. Amen. Who has delivered your enemies into your hands. And in that rejoicing, in as much as Abraham comes to give glory and honor to the Lord, the first thing he does, of all the spoils, he gives a tenth, he gives a tithe of all. He gives a tithe of all. And that's why this morning we changed a little. In as much as we did the announcements earlier, we're coming to the table of the Lord. That as you receive the bread and the wine, you're going to bring to the Lord your tithe. Like Abraham, because you're the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You are the descendants. And like Abraham, as we have our victory, maybe you didn't have your victory, but we're standing in faith today. We're believing, we're receiving our victory today because we receive our victory today by faith. And you might not see it in the natural. We come to honor the Lord with our tithe like Abraham did. Like Abraham did. And church, let me just say something. This is a covenant meal. This is a covenant. The bread and the wine is covenant. So is your tithe. It's covenant. Some things in life you never break is covenant. And that's why the Lord ate the bread. Why? Because it's a covenant relationship. It's a covenant relationship. And the Lord does not break covenant. He does not break covenant. He doesn't want us to break covenant. Amen. He does not want to break up, but he gave a tithe of all. And then, picking up on verse 22-23, he says, now the king of Sodom said to Abram, give me the persons and take the goods. Pick up on, now the king of Sodom said to Abram, give me the persons and take the goods for yourself. And that's what the enemy will try to do, to try and divert you. Try and do a deal with you and say, you know what? Come, let's just share the spoil. Let's just share the victory. and come into a place of being unequally yoked. And he goes on to say, but Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have raised my hand to the Lord God Most High. You see, when you raise your hand to the Lord Most High, God Most High, when you give your heart to him in covenant, you cannot raise your hand to any other God. You cannot raise your hand to anything else other than the Lord God Almighty. Because at the time when we have our victory, when the time we have our breakthrough, we forget who gave us the victory. We forget to worship. We forget to lift up his name and glorify his name and worship him. Like the time when you were in the valley. Because you see, when you're in the valley season, it's actually easy to worship the Lord because you're in such a desperate situation. You're in such a desperate, just a dire position. You have no choice. But more so, church, more so, when you come and have your breakthrough. Because let me say something. The Lord has a wave of breakthrough, a wave of miracles that's coming. Don't ever get satisfied and complacent by just one miracle and one victory. I don't know about you. I want miracles and waves upon waves upon waves. Hallelujah. Sometimes that's why I think and appreciate the seaside. Because I see the continuity of the waves that never stop. And Lord, I thank you that your miracle and your breakthrough in every area of my life continue to come. Because I want to go to a higher position. I want to move to a higher position. The worst thing to be is the place of complacency, a place of stagnation, a place of comfort. Because he never asked us to do that. And he doesn't want us to do that. So I've raised my hand to the Lord God, who said, the possessor of heaven and earth. And look at what he says. That I will take nothing from a thread to a sandal strap, that I will take anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abraham rich. Hallelujah. Let me repeat that. That I will take nothing. This is Abraham talking to the king of Sodom. I will take nothing from a thread to a sandal strap. And then I will not take anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abraham rich. Oh, taking a stand. Taking a stand for righteousness. Taking a stand for the God Almighty that you and I serve. You see, Sodom's offer to share the spoils for the battle of Abraham, and unlike Melchizedek, brings no blessing. You see, the king of Sodom brings no blessing. Unrighteousness brings no blessings in your life. So if Abraham went to accept his offer from the king of Sodom, the king of Sodom will enhance his prestige, claiming that he enriched Abraham. He enriched. You see, here's the thing with people. People will always say, listen, I have set him up. I've made him rich. He is who he is because of me. See, I don't know about you. Because I rely on no man. I don't rely on no man. My God is my only source. Amen. Because I continue to get reminded, lest anyone should say, I have made you rich. I have made you rich. Amen. Because, as you know, the faith that befalls Sodom later confirms his wicked intentions. His wicked intention. So it would be very wrong for Abraham also to accept the king's offer, as he would threaten the Lord's promise to make Abraham's name great. Look at what it says in Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12. It says here, it says in chapter 2, chapter 12, beg your pardon, verse 2, that I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. If Abraham took and shared the spoils with the king of Sodom, he would miss what God has promised in his word, that I will make your name great. Be careful. Be careful that you don't miss that which God has purposed, that which God has promised you. that which God has promised. Also, to accept that offer from the king of Sodom would not have glorified God, would have taken the glory away from the Lord God Almighty. But with Abraham rejecting the offer, he testified of the Lord's mighty power and left no doubt who got the victory. Left no doubt who got the victory. You have to continue to acknowledge him, the God who is the deliverer, who brings you the victory. Amen. Hallelujah. If you open with me in Psalms 110, and picking up from verse 4, 110 verse 4. I'm taking you somewhere, but the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. And the Lord shall send the rod of your strength out of Zion, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people shall be bounties in the day of power, in the beauty of holiness from the womb of the morning. You have to do good. But look what it says in verse 4. It says, the Lord has sworn that he will not relent. The Lord has sworn and will not relent. You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. So we're coming from Genesis, coming to Psalms, and it's all pointing to the order of Melchizedek. It's all pointing to the order of Jesus. And the Lord is here at your right hand. He shall execute kings in the day of his wrath. And verse 6 says that he shall judge among the nations. He will fill the places with dead bodies. He shall execute the heads of many countries. But it says also he shall judge among the nations. I did some research of it. And it shows that in the caves of Qumran, I'm not sure if you're going to go there, but it's a place that lots of people go there. I've been there, where the scrolls are and so forth. But the caves of Qumran in Israel predicts that Melchizedek was the divinely appointed judge in the courts of heaven. Oh, when I read that, when I looked at that, I said, my God, this ties in with my previous message. Melchizedek was divinely appointed judge in the courts of heaven. And as you know, Melchizedek was a type of Jesus. It's the same Jesus who had been divinely appointed for you and I in the courts of heaven. Confirming what was ministered a couple of weeks ago, a month ago, whatever it was. That he sits in the courts of heaven. Hallelujah. So, let's just go to Hebrews chapter 6. And I'm starting up now, which is the main scripture. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13. So, picking up from there. For when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely, the blessing I will bless and multiplying I will multiply. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For many did swear by the greater, and an oath of confirmation is for them an end of all dispute. Thus God determined to show more abundantly to the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, and confirmed it by oath, that by two immutable things, in which it is impossible for God to lie, we might have strong for this consolation. We have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope that he set before us. Verse 19 says, this hope we have as an anchor for our soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil. Church, I want you to ever, from this day forth, never, never, ever come into any doubt. Because the word says this hope that we have, this faith that we have, this promise that we have, is an anchor of our soul. It's an anchor of our soul. An anchor will never be moved. No matter the winds, no matter the water and the wind, it will not be moved. Because we have a sure anchor. an anchor that is sure and steadfast, which enters the presence, which enters the Holy of Holies, which enters the throne room, who enters and goes beyond the veil. Hallelujah. Where the forerunner has entered for us. Jesus, having become the high priest forever. Forever. According to the order of Melchizedek. You see, church, we don't have to be reminded of our sins all the time. We don't have to go make atonement every time. Yes, we need to repent when you sin. But you don't have to go and have a high priest. You don't have to have a mirage. Like in the old days. You know, as Hindus, you had a mirage, but he would do the prayers for you. You don't need a mirage. Today the mirages are prophets. You don't need that. You don't need a prince and go a priest to make confession behind a closed door. You don't need a priest to go make a confession. I'm not knocking anybody else in other religions. I'm just saying that's the reality. Amen? Because you see, we can enter directly and enter into the Holy of Holies because we already have the high priest. We already have the high priest. And that's what he promised. That's what he promised. Amen. That he is our high priest. He is the king of righteousness. He is the king of peace. And in verse 7, in chapter 7, beg your pardon, it goes on to say, for this Melchizedek, the king of Salem, priest of the Most High, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of kings and blessed him, whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, being translated. You know, there's been some debate in the past about whether tithing is of the Old Testament or the New Testament. They say it's only of the Old Testament, but this is not in the New Testament. It's in the New Testament because they would have referred to Abraham as Abraham in the New Testament. He's not Abraham. He's not Abraham, beg your pardon. He's not Abraham. And so tithing is also of the New Covenant. So let's just get that cleared up. King of righteousness and also king of Salem, meaning king of peace. And yes, without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. He's promising he'll never leave you nor forsake you. But here's the interesting part. When you find and do some research on Melchizedek, he had no genealogy. He had no genealogy. Jesus had no genealogy. I don't know about you, I got no genealogy. I might have come from my parents who came out of India, but my genealogy is now in the lineage of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's my lineology now. Genealogy. That is my genealogy. So you better forget the things that are behind us, forget the things of the past. Hallelujah. Because you've come into a path of righteousness. You've come into this new path. So Melchizedek has no united in Jesus. And that's why I can say that Melchizedek was a type of Jesus. Amen. He was a type of Jesus. And he says, and now consider how great this man was to whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of all the spoils. And indeed those who are the sons of Levi, who receive the priesthood, have a commandment to receive tithe from people according to the law that is from their brethren, though they have come from the loins of Abraham. But he whose genealogy is not derived from them received tithe from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. Now beyond all contradiction, the lesser is blessed by the better. Hallelujah. You see, when I come before him, the Lord God Almighty, I'm the lesser. But I thank you, Lord, that I always get blessed by the better. In fact, I always get blessed by the best. Because he's the only one. He's my only source. He's my only source that I look to. Because I know when I look to man, I will get a small reward. It might look big in the interim. It might look big in the natural. But if you take the reward from man, like you would share with the king of Sodom, you already got your reward. But I don't know about you, my reward My rewards come from Him, the Lord God Almighty, because I know when He rewards me, the rewards are unlimited. The rewards continuous. The rewards and the breakthrough and the miracles are continue like the waves of the sea. Amen. The immortal may receive tithes, but then he goes on and began from verse 7. Therefore, the perfection went through the Levitical priesthood. What further need was there for another priest should arise according to the old order of Melchizedek and not be called according to the order of Aaron? For the priesthood being changed of necessity, there is also a change of law. For he whom these things were spoken belongs to another tribe. Hallelujah. And picking up on verse 15, it is yet far more evident if, in the likeness of Melchizedek, there arises another priest, who has come not according to the law, but of a fleshly commandment, but according to the power of an endless life. The power of an endless life. Church, the day you die is not the end of your life. Thank God, because of the gift of salvation and soteria that you and I have received, our life continues forever and ever. Hallelujah. What a glorious promise. What a glorious promise. That we know we're going to a place of eternity. For he testifies you're a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. On the one hand, there is annulling of the former commandment because of its weaknesses and unoptimal. And that's what God does. That's what God does when you bring weakness and you bring condemnation and you bring religious, what can I say? Rules and regulations, that it kills the spirit. It kills the spirit. You know, I remember some time back, I think, I wouldn't mention the church, but some time back, maybe about 30, 30 years, 40 years back, and maybe Jay you remember, is that when you take your communion, and the ushers and the deacons, I take the communion, you had to wear a black or a navy suit, you had to wear a dark suit. I remember that, Jake. Am I right? You had to wear a dark suit, a black suit or a navy suit, you had to wear a dark and a navy suit. And when I look at this, I said, but why? What? Are we coming to your funeral? Are we coming to mourn? But this table is a table of a celebration of life. Of resurrected life. And so we need to come rejoicing. Coming in our bright colors. Because we're celebrating the life of Jesus. And the same life that is within us. This is the life we've been called to. Not a life of death and doom. This is a life of celebration. The life that he gave us, that he created for us. For you and I. Hallelujah. And it goes on in verse 5, so much more Jesus, he says, has become a surety of a better covenant. Another translation says that he has become a guarantee. It's more than a bank guarantee. A guarantee for a better covenant for you and I. And I'm not going to go through all the promises of a better covenant. You should know that. You should see what the promises of God are. And he's saying to you, whatever promise I've made in my word, I'm guaranteeing you today. I'm signing surety on your behalf because of the covenant you've made with your God. You chose to make covenant with your living God. And like Abraham, you've raised your hand unto the Lord God Most High. And you've given your heart to him in a covenant relationship. In a covenant relationship. But he, because he continues forever, has an unchangeable priesthood. Therefore, he is able to say to those, to the uttermost, those who have come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for us. He continues to make intercession for us. He continues to be our advocate in the course of heaven for us. He continues. And that's why he says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will always be with you always. Church, that's a promise. I don't know about you. That's a promise I want. I know I have it. Amen. We need to be firm and steadfast and sure This is the God we serve. For such a high priest was fitted for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens. Who does not need daily, as those high priests, to offer sacrifices first for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once and for all. This he did once and for all when he offered himself up for us. And that's why we come to the time of the bread and the wine and of taking this once and for all. We celebrate that which he had done for us. Amen. That which he has done for us. So Jesus, like Melchizedek, is a priest in his own right, directly created by God himself, not from any tribe, not from any lineage or genealogy, hallelujah, but rather from a priest from a different order. And you know, when I look at this and I see that he wasn't of any order, any genealogy order, neither was Melchizedek. And I look at my life, and I look at your own life, you look at your own life, and you might think, you know what, I haven't come from a genealogy of pastors. My family, my wife's family, yes, but not my family. My family, there's no genealogy of pastors and priests and all of those things. Okay, particularly in the ministry. We don't have that. But, and I looked at this and I said, like Melchizedek, and like Jesus, he didn't have the genealogy. You see, because God created me. Like you and I, we don't have a genealogy. But God had a project. He created you before the foundations of the earth. Because he knew you. He knew that one day you're going to serve him. One day you're going to worship him. One day you're going to do great exploits for him. So don't ever think you can't do anything because you're not of a particular lineage. Okay? You don't have to be the Hagen family or the Copeland family or any of these other families that you need to follow that line. Yes, you need to sometimes. Okay, so, unless God calls you. But for you and I that might not come from any lineage of the priesthood, don't ever think that you are not called. Don't ever think that you can't be used from the Lord God Almighty by him. You cannot. Don't ever think that. I mean, we all came from unbelieving background. We came from Hindu background. But God appointed us. God chose us. God called us out for such a time as this. For such a time as this. So don't ever think you're insignificant. The fact that you are born again, the fact that you have Christ in you, there's a calling upon you. There's a calling of, there's a divine destiny upon you. Don't ever think for a moment you have no purpose, you have no destiny. God doesn't have a, he has a plan for every single individual. And that plan is not about standing on the pulpit. It's about affecting and affecting nations and people and communities that are around you. In your workplaces, in your business, at university, at school, whatever the case might be. Whatever you do, as a housewife, your neighbor, He's called you. You see, it's like as if Jesus went against the grave. And I can recall I went against the grave because I chose to lift up my hand unto the God Most High against what my family had said, against what my family wanted me to be. And sometimes you need to do something radical. Something that is out of the order, something that is contrary to the stream, as it were. Because God's calling us to that higher level, to that higher dimension. He's pushing us. He's pushing us, encouraging us to that higher level. Hallelujah. You see, let me say something. Supernatural does not come from a natural order. Supernatural does not come from a natural or a normal order. Supernatural comes when you're stepping out in faith, when you're stepping out from the boat to the water, you're stepping out doing something different. And that's not normal, that's not natural. And that's what the Lord has calling us to do. So this morning, even as we partake of the bread and the wine, remember that which he has done for us. Hallelujah. But more important, that before we partake, you might be sitting here this morning and says, you know what, I don't know this Melchizedek. I don't know this type of Melchizedek. I don't know this Jesus. Because he is the, I don't know him as my Lord and Savior. And who do I put my hands up to? Who is this Lord God Most High? And you might be sitting here and say, do not have a destiny, do not have a purpose. But I want to show you something. God knew you while you were yet in your mother's womb. And this morning I want to give you an opportunity. I can't save you, your pastor can't save you. But there's one who can save you, which is Jesus Christ. He's my God, he's my Savior, he's my Lord. Amen. He's the anointed one. And so I want to give you an opportunity this morning. That maybe you don't know him as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you don't know him. And you want to know him. Maybe you have known him in the past and you've drifted away and you've denied him. And maybe you've entangled yourself like with the king of Sodom. And now you say, Lord, I'm coming back to my father. I'm coming back to the house.
Yeah.
I want to give you that opportunity this morning. So every eye closed, head bowed. No one looking around. No one looking around. I want to give you that opportunity. That you might know him. Because it's the same God I serve. He's an amazing God. But more so, he's my Abba Father. See, if you might be sitting here this morning and you want to say, I want to know the God that you serve. The God that delivered you, the God that gave you the victories. I want to know this God. And if you want to know my Jesus, won't you just raise your hand? I want to give you that opportunity. Because what decision we've made in this church is that we want to give every individual an opportunity to give their heart to the Lord. Is there anyone here this morning? Won't you just raise your hands? And this is a key moment in the service. Because it's not about anything else, but it's about Jesus. It's about making your life right. And you say, you know what, I want this new covenant. I want to make covenant with this God. So if there's anyone here this morning, won't you just raise your hand? Won't you raise your hand this morning? Is there anyone? It's all family. Everyone saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And this morning, before we partake of the communion, we're going to rise and stand up and the team can come up. Hallelujah. Before we take the bread and the wine, we're going to take up an offering. In fact, we're going to take up the tithe. I don't know about you, I want to follow the pattern of the Word of God. Because I'm declaring this morning that we have received our victory. I'm decreeing and I'm prophesying this morning we have received our breakthrough. And Lord, like Abraham, we come, oh God Almighty, we come before you. Lord God, in our time of victory by faith, we believe, we receive, we come and give our tithes and our offering before you. Because Lord, that's the first thing we want to honor you with. We want to honor you with our tithes and our offering this morning, oh God. And Lord, we just thank you this day, Father, because we acknowledge this is our covenant. We're in covenant with you. And we give our covenant tithe unto you, God. And we give our offering unto you this morning. And Lord, we just thank you this morning. Thank you, Father God, this day, that we're to be obedient to your word. And obedient, oh God, to what you're telling us and speak to us this morning. And Lord, we thank you this day. As we receive the tithe, we give you honor, we give you glory, oh God, this day. Because Lord God Almighty, we thank you this day. We thank you, Father God, we know that you promised that you rebuke the devourer of our sins. But Lord God, we come to give our tithe to the God Most High. Thank you. Actually, says you can receive the tithe.
We give you glory, Father, this day. I release the blessing of God the Father
and the Son and the Holy Spirit upon every son and every daughter. I pray the precious blood of Jesus upon each one. I pray the hand of God. I pray the favor of God. I pray even this week the Lord will cause him to triumph. I even prophesy what the enemy has meant for evil, God will turn it on for good. In the name of Jesus, I prophesy your breakthrough. I prophesy your suddenly. I prophesy it will come. Everything at once this day. I prophesy what the enemy has stolen, he will pay back sevenfold. The Lord will cause him to vomit it out. The Lord will take it out of his belly. It is coming back. I bless you. You will be blessed going out. You will be blessed in your body. You will be blessed in your meeting bowl. You will be blessed in your job. You will be blessed in your schools. You will be blessed wherever you go. For the blessing of God knows no limits. The blessing of God adds no sorrow. So you be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. In the name of Jesus. Somebody give him a praise offering. Hallelujah. Beloved, September is going to be an exciting month.